Hello learners, this is Sangamitra Suryapani from National Institute of Open Schooling. Today we will discuss and explain the second lesson of your senior secondary biology course, that is the kingdom Monera, Protista and Fungi. Today we have with us Dr. Ranjana Saxena, from associate professor from Delhi University. Welcome ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, on behalf of our learners, I would ask, as there are many organisms on this earth, how can we classify them, or is there any specific method to classify them to make them remember? Is there any specific method?
Yes, Dr. Sangamitra, you are right that there are so many organisms on this earth and it's very difficult to remember all of them. And therefore, it was Linnaeus in 1900 who classified the organisms into two. And it was known as the two kingdom classification. He divided all the organisms into plantae and animalia on the basis of whether they could manufacture their own food or could move about. All those organisms which could manufacture their own food with the help of chlorophyll and sunlight were grouped under kingdom plantae, whereas all those who could not manufacture their own food were grouped under kingdom animalia. Also, there were plants belonging to the kingdom plantae could not move about, whereas animals belonging to the kingdom animalia could move about. But the problem was that there are certain other organisms which are plant-like in some respects and like the animals in some other respects. For example, there are organisms which can manufacture their own food and are autotrophs, but at the same time they can move about with the help of flagella. Also, there are organisms which have got cell wall like the plants, but they are capable of moving about, and therefore this classification of two kingdom classification was becoming a little disoriented, or we can say it was not possible to define all the organisms into two. And therefore, it was Whittaker later on who divided or who classified the organisms into five kingdom on the basis of whether they were single celled or multicellular, with a nucleus or without a nucleus. And depending on that, he classified the organisms into five kingdom: kingdom Monera, kingdom Protista, kingdom Fungi, kingdom Plantae, and kingdom Animalia. Kingdom Monerae were different from the remaining four kingdom because they lacked a nucleus, and therefore they were known as prokaryotes, whereas the remaining four, the Protista, the Fungi, Plantae and Animalia, all had a well-defined nucleus in which was present the DNA, and therefore they were known as eukaryotes. So the fundamental difference between the kingdom Monera and the other four kingdoms was that in Monera the nucleus is absent. Kingdom Monera consisted of two groups, eubacteria and archaebacteria. As the name suggests, archae means first. So it is believed that these bacteria existed first of all and were the primitive one. And kingdom Monera included both these, eubacteria as well as the archaebacteria. Eu means true, so they are the true bacteria, whereas archaebacteria are the ones which they can live under very harsh conditions. For example, they can live at high temperatures. The other organisms are not able to withstand such conditions.
Ma'am, can you please give some examples?
Methanogenic bacteria, they live in sewage and also in the intestine of many animals. The thermoacidophilic bacteria, they live in the hot conditions, and the halophilic bacteria, they live in salty condition. Now, all these bacteria, they are grouped under archaebacteria because they are able to live under harsh conditions. And also these archaebacteria are different from the eubacteria in the fact that they have got a rRNA which is very much different from the RNA which is present in eubacteria. So now we shall be more emphasizing ourselves on the kingdom Monera, because we have already said the differences between the Archibacteria and the Monera. There are many more differences, but we would be concentrating on the kingdom Monera. The kingdom Monera, as I said, Eubacteria. So now we are concentrating on the Eubacteria. Eu means true. So these are the true bacteria. And the fundamental feature that comes to our mind is that all the Eubacteria are prokaryotic. And just now I told you, what are prokaryotic organisms? All those organisms lack a nucleus. And if they lack a nucleus, do they lack a DNA? No, they don't lack a DNA. But the DNA in them is not confined within the nucleus as they lack them, but it is present in the cytoplasm. And the area where they are present in the cytoplasm, it is known as the nucleoid. There is yet another type of DNA known as plasmids, which are rings of DNA, and these are present in the Eubacteria. So Eubacteria have got plasmids, but these plasmids do not take part in reproduction, but they are very important because they contain genes for antibiotic resistance, and this is very important from the biotechnology point of view. As you can see here, it is a structure of the bacterial cell as a whole, where you find that the bacteria is enclosed, or the outer wall of the bacteria consists of a cell wall. The cell wall in case of bacteria is made up of peptidoglycan. Now this peptidoglycan is absent in the plants, because in case of plants the cell wall is made up of cellulose, whereas in the case of fungi the cell wall is made up of chitin. So here you see that although the eukaryotes, also some of the eukaryotes have the cell wall, but the composition of the cell wall is different from the prokaryotes. The cell wall gives rigidity to the bacteria, or it gives shape to the bacteria, and also it protects the bacteria. There is an additional layer which is present in some of the bacteria but not in all the bacteria, which is outside the cell wall, and this is known as the capsule. As you can see in this, the blue stars here where they are shown, it is the capsule layer. And the capsule layer, like the cell wall, protects the cell, helps the cell to adhere to surfaces and nutrients, and assists in retaining the moisture. Now, inner to the cell wall, you will find a plasma membrane or cell membrane. Now, this is a membrane which allows the coming in of the nutrients and going out of the nutrient. It's a semi-permeable membrane which allows certain substances to move into the cell and certain substances out of the cell. Also, in this particular slide, you can see there are small thread-like structures which are known as pili or pilus. Now, these are proteinaceous in nature, and they help in attachment of one bacteria to the other bacteria. So pili are thread-like structures which are very similar to the flagella, yet they are different from the flagella because the thickness of this is very less as compared to the flagella. Also, they are smaller in size and are made up of proteins.
So does they help in movement also?
No. In movement, it is basically the flagella which helps the bacteria in movement. And you can see here, as Dr. Sangamitra, you have rightly said that they have got flagella for movement. They can have one, two, or they can have more than two flagella, which helps them to move about. Also present in the cytoplasm are ribosomes. Ribosomes are cell organelles which are responsible for protein synthesis. The other cell organelles like mitochondria, Golgi complex, chloroplast, etc. are absent in them. In other words, the cell organelles bounded by a definite membrane are absent in them. However, you find these structure organelles present in the eukaryotes. Now, there is, once you have understood the structure of the bacteria, children, you can make your own bacteria on a thermocol, and you can have a model of it, which will be easier for you to understand for your revision also. You can make use of plasticine, different colors of plasticine for that. You can have red plasticine, yellow plasticine, green, or whatever color you like. And with different colors, for example, for the capsule, you can use one color. Make the outer boundary with that color to show that it has got capsule. In order to that, you can use another color of the plasticine to show the cell wall. Similarly, you can use the third color to show the cell membrane. And then the cytoplasm, you could color it yourself on a, you can make this on a thermocol and color the cytoplasm. The DNA, which is present in nucleoids, and remember they don't have a nucleus. So this DNA is present in the cytoplasm clustered together, and that you can show with some thread, or you can use whatever material you can think of. You can use that instead of plasticine. You could use different colored threads for this. And then they have a plasmid, which is a round DNA, and that you can ring DNA, so that you can use with another thread and make a circle and put it in the center. Similarly, the ribosomes can be shown with some other material, like you can use bindis to show the ribosomes, or you can show stars to show the ribosomes inside the cytoplasm. Pili and the flagella can be shown with threads of different thickness. Okay. Pili can be shown with the thread, which is very small, and the thickness is also less. Similarly, you can show flagella, which are long, with long threads, and the thickness could be more than that. So once you have made this on a thermocol, you can keep it, and that would be interesting and nice for you for your revision just before the exam. So that is how you can really make your study easy. Isn't that easy for the children to make Sangamitra, the model of
Yes, ma'am, that is very easy, and we will show them how we can make it.
They also feed like any other eukaryote. Even these prokaryotes feed, and they have got different modes of feeding. For example, you will find that these bacteria can either be autotrophs, they can be saprophytes, they can be symbionts, or they can be parasites. Autotrophs, like the blue-green algae, which are also known as cyanobacteria. Now these, as you can see here, are green in color. And the mere fact that they are green in color suggests that they contain a green colored pigment, which is known as chlorophyll. And with the help of sunlight, water and carbon dioxide, they are able to make their own food. So they are known as autotrophs. The saprophytes live on dead decaying organic matter. And these saprophytes, then they are helping us. How they are helping us is that they break down the complex organic compounds into simpler ones and recycle the nutrient. And at the same time, they are enriching the soil. So these bacteria are helping us. The symbiotic bacteria, Dr. Sangamitra, you must have heard of certain bacteria living in the leguminous plants. And
rhizobium
that lives in the root nodules of the leguminous plants. And in the process, it is converting the nitrogen into amino acids, so that these amino acids can be taken up by the plants for their own food.
They convert atmospheric nitrogen into utilitic nitrogen.
Yes, they convert the atmospheric nitrogen into
utilize the atmospheric nitrogen.
Yes. And these then are taken up by the plants as food. And the plants in turn are giving them the shelter. Similarly, we have got parasitic bacteria. Now, these parasitic bacteria are harmful and they cause diseases. So, on one hand, we have bacteria that are very important for us and our friends, and at the same time we have bacteria which are our enemies because they are causing certain diseases.
So there are many pathogenic bacteria and beneficial bacteria.
Yes, there are many pathogenic as well as beneficial bacteria. I'll be talking about them later also.
So ma'am, you have already told us that there is a mitochondria and Golgi bodies are absent. So how this breakdown of food takes place into that?
Yes, that's a very good question. In the absence of mitochondria, where does the food breakdown of food takes place? Well, they have got certain organelles which are known as mesosomes. As you can see here, the red colored ones are mesosomes. It is in these mesosomes that the food breakdown of food takes place and the energy is made available to them. And these monerans can respire both aerobically and anaerobically, which means that in the absence of oxygen also, they are capable of respiring. Just like any other eukaryote, these monerans are able to reproduce both asexually as well as sexually. Mm-hmm. Now, asexual mode of reproduction is by binary fission, whereas sexual mode of reproduction is by conjugation. The usual method of reproduction in these bacteria is by asexual method. Now, in this you can see here that in the first slide, the DNA is present at a hard compact structure in the nucleoid. Remember that nucleus is absent in them. So, it is present in the cytoplasm and you can see the plasmid as well. Now, in the second slide, you find that the DNA has replicated. You can see the two different colors. In the third slide, the DNA has moved to the two opposite poles. When the DNA has moved to the two opposite poles, the cell body, it goes invagination occur, or the cytoplasm moves inside. And as it grows inside, the complete break occurs, and you can see in the fifth slide that the cytoplasm has totally gone inwards to meet the two ends, as a result of which the two daughter cells are formed. Now, these two daughter cells separate out. The one strand of the plasmid is shared by each of the daughter cells and the other strand is made by each one of them. So, now both the daughter cells are independent bacteria and can move about. In this particular slide, the same thing has been discussed. They can also reproduce by sexual method, and this sexual method of reproduction takes place by conjugation. Now, in conjugation, one of the bacteria acts as a donor bacteria, whereas the second bacteria acts as a recipient bacteria. The donor bacteria gives out a pilus. Pilus, I've already told earlier, is made up of protein and helps to join with the other bacteria. So, this pilus joins with the recipient bacteria or attaches with the pilus of the recipient bacteria, and a protoplasmic bridge is formed between the two, as you can see here. And the one strand of the plasmid goes into the other, and their exchange of material takes place, and one strand of this gets into the other one and a new strand is formed.
Ma'am, can you please tell our learners about the examples of asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction? Is there any particular specific example?
Specific as such for the sexual, any bacteria could go in for a sexual and asexual. Cyanobacteria, that is the blue-green algae, the usual method of reproduction is by the asexual method only. Once learners or students, you have learnt about the asexual and sexual mode of reproduction, you can again
do some activity.
Practice it yourself. If you have understood it carefully, you can enumerate the differences between the asexual and sexual mode of reproduction in bacteria on a chart paper, draw the diagram and write the differences. So, you can revise it yourself. The differences between the two. Just as you have made a model of the bacterial cell, you can make a model of the asexual method of reproduction or the sexual method of reproduction with any of the available material. You don't have to go to the market to buy the material. These materials will be easily available at home also. So, you can make the model.
Ma'am, what are the economic importance of these bacteria?
Yeah. Just before, we were talking about the useful bacteria and I told you that they are both beneficial as well as the harmful bacteria. So, we'll talk about the useful bacteria first. as we have already said, that these bacteria, like the rhizobium, lives in the root nodules of the leguminous plants and picks up the atmospheric nitrogen to make this available to the plants as their food, and in turn the plants are giving them protection. So they are helping us in converting the atmospheric nitrogen into useful compounds so that it can be utilized by the plants. At the same time, there are certain other bacteria like the soil bacteria, Azotobacter, which are found in the soil and feed on the dead decaying organic matter. And as they feed on the dead decaying matter, they are getting the food not right, but at the same time they are converting the complex food material or the complex organic matter into simpler compounds, as a result of which the nutrients are not only made available to the plants, but also they are recycled back into the atmosphere. And since they are feeding on the dead decaying organic matter, they are also cleaning our environment by removing these dead decaying organic matter from our environment. All of you must be eating curd at home. And you must have seen your mother setting curd at home. What does she do? She takes 1 teaspoon of curd, already set curd, and then adds milk to it and warm milk, a little warm milk, and then leaves it for 3 to 4 hours depending on the temperature. And after that, when you see it, the curd is set. Now, what is it in the curd that sets the milk, or that converts the milk into curd? It is the lactobacilli which are present in the curd, which acts on the lactose sugar which is present in the milk and converts into lactic acid. And it is this lactic acid which is responsible for setting up of the curd. So you see that how these bacteria are very useful to us. And do you know, when you fall sick, the doctors at times, not always, gives you antibiotics. What are these antibiotics and from where do you get them? Of course, for you these are medicines to cure the diseases. But these antibiotics are prepared from bacteria only. For example, streptomycin is made from Streptomyces bacteria. So you see, on one hand, I've told you so many useful things about bacteria, but there are certain harmful bacteria also. As I've already told you, that these bacteria can cause deadly diseases. You're all aware of typhoid, cholera, tetanus, diphtheria, etc. All these diseases are caused by bacteria only. And for example, cholera is caused by Vibrio cholerae, typhoid by Salmonella typhi. There are many more diseases. Now, what you can do as an activity, you can find out the names of various diseases which are caused by bacteria and the booster doses or the doses that you have got at the time of birth. And what are the preventive measures and control? You can take the help of your parents or internet or your elders for this particular activity. So, you know that bacteria not only useful, but also they are harmful to us.
So, the ma'am, Kingdom Monera consists of simplest structural organism, and they are the first living forms which have evolved on this earth.
It is believed that they are the first ones to have come on this earth, first prokaryotic organisms to have come on this earth.
So, learners, I hope this lesson or this program gives you the better understanding about the Monera characteristics of organism belonging to this kingdom. Thanks for coming to our studio, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks to our learners.
घर बैठे पाएं राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा संस्थान यानी NIOS में एडमिशन, वो भी एकदम आसान तरीके से, जिससे शिक्षार्थियों को होगी समय और धन दोनों की बचत। NIOS से शिक्षा कभी भी कहीं भी। शिक्षार्थियों, क्या आप जानते हैं NIOS में एडमिशन लेने का सरल और सुगम तरीका, जिससे शिक्षार्थियों को ऑनलाइन प्रवेश लेने में सहूलियत मिलती है। NIOS में प्रवेश की प्रक्रिया पूर्णतया ऑनलाइन है। शिक्षार्थी घर बैठे इंटरनेट द्वारा प्रवेश के लिए सबसे पहले NIOS की वेबसाइट www.nios.ac.in पर लॉगिन करें, अपना ईमेल आईडी और पासवर्ड डालकर अपना पंजीकरण करें। पंजीकरण के बाद लॉगिन करने पर ऑनलाइन प्रवेश हेतु आवेदन पत्र खुलेगा। आवेदन पत्र को निर्देशानुसार भरें और प्रिंट आउट लें। इस प्रिंट आउट पर अपनी फोटो संलग्न करें। ऑनलाइन प्रवेश के लिए शुल्क हेतु भुगतान के तरीके हैं, क्रेडिट कार्ड के द्वारा, डेबिट कार्ड के द्वारा, राष्ट्रीयकृत बैंक के ड्राफ्ट के माध्यम से, जो कि सचिव NIOS नई दिल्ली या नोएडा के पक्ष में देय हो। भरे हुए आवेदन पत्र के साथ साथ डिमांड ड्राफ्ट और संलग्न किए जाने वाले दस्तावेज हैं जन्म रजिस्ट्रार के जिला कार्यालय से जारी जन्म प्रमाण पत्र की सत्यापित प्रति, जिसमें जन्म तिथि अंकित हो, पिछले विद्यालय से प्राप्त विद्यालय छोड़ने का प्रमाण पत्र जिसमें आवेदक की जन्म तिथि लिखी हो, प्रवेश फॉर्म का प्रिंट आउट NIOS के संबद्ध क्षेत्र केंद्रों पर 10 दिनों में पहुंच जाना चाहिए, अन्यथा उचित दस्तावेज ना लगे होने पर आवेदन फॉर्म रद्द किया जा सकता है। प्रवेश प्रक्रिया की पुष्टि होने के बाद शिक्षार्थियों को परिचय पत्र व अध्ययन सामग्री डाक द्वारा तुरंत पहुंचाई जाती है। ऑनलाइन प्रवेश एक बहुत ही सुगम और सुविधाजनक प्रवेश प्रणाली है। ऑनलाइन ऑन टाइम फॉर सेफ एंड सिक्योर एडमिशन।
प्रकाशित करने राहों को आलोकित करने हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने, हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने। कभी पढ़े हम कहीं पढ़े वे विषय की लोच से युक्त हो, मित्रों हम उठे और जागे मंजिल आने की ध्वनि सुने, हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने।